All right. This week we have, or today we have a whole bunch of indie movies we're just gonna blow through that I've been watching over the span of 2 or 3 weeks. We're gonna start with The End of the Tour, which is James Ponsoldt's movie, who did Smashed and Spectacular Now.
Two phenomenal movies.
And he has given us this movie starring Jesse Eisenberg and Jason Segel about an interviewer for Rolling Stone, I think it was, who is interviewing David Foster Wallace, the very famous author of Infinite Jest. And that's pretty much it. It's basically kind of somewhat a buddy road trip movie from then on. There's a lot of, like, yeah, for that side of you, there's a lot of the whole, for the intellect inside you, there's the whole thing about artistry and fame, and it's also a talk on that, too, when Segel has his big dialogue-heavy scenes. But for the most part, it's really just kind of the star of this movie is the band between the two of them. And I was never really... Jesse Eisenberg is somebody that I will respect forever for his performance on The Social Network. Right. No matter what he does. Even whatever the fuck he's doing with Lex Luthor. Whatever he wants to do, we'll let him do it because he gave us that performance as Zuckerberg. Segel, I was not sure. I had heard a lot about him when this was at Sundance, and from then on. And everybody was saying how great Segel was. And he's always seemed, like, really likable, and there's nothing that I dislike him in. He's just generally not somebody that's been a standout to me. Like, even as much as I love Jeff Who Lives at Home, and he is the title character, it's Ed Helms and Susan Sarandon. I really, really remember that from that movie. And even Judy Greer. So he's never really been an actor that's, like, absolutely stood out to me, so I was curious to go into a movie he was getting so much praise for. And he really earns that praise. This performance is not something that I had... I mean, maybe he's shown it elsewhere, like on How I Met Your Mother or something else I haven't seen, but he's really, really good in this, and he just... It's one of those movies where you could kind of see it as... I don't know much about who the real guy was and what he was... Apparently, like, there have been some complaints that his performance isn't exactly accurate.
Mm-hmm.
But those people will still say, if you see this as, like, a fictionalized version of him, then, you know, wonderful. But obviously, I cannot distinguish one from the other because I don't really know much about him apart from this movie, really.
Right.
So, And another thing is that it's not like there is apparently an obvious outcome. And instead of the movie just kind of building to that and you kind of waiting for that, like, big emotional scene or whatever it's going to lead to, or it would lead to in another movie, Eisenberg's character getting the news of his suicide is the opening of the movie. And then that's the way they establish it, and then it's never really touched on again. Wow. We just kind of know that it's going to be coming at some point, long after their interaction. So, I was really liking it a lot, almost loving it, but then, once we get about an hour or so in, they kind of bring in this, conflict, where we're introduced to a couple of, women who enter the story, one of which I believe is his ex, who Eisenberg is kind of, you know, headed towards, even though he has his girlfriend, who is Anna Chlumsky, back at home. And this, what was going on between them with the banter and the dialogue and it almost being a buddy movie, really. At this point in the story, they kind of, almost to a point of no return, start, like, kind of being almost like a bickering couple. And that kind of sours it just a little bit, but still, the performances are so good, and these characters really, really hook you so much. It's pretty easy to forgive in the long run. A lot of people come out of this really, really loving it. Like, it's been on some top 10 lists that I've seen around, from, like, those, like, middle of the year top 10 lists, and then ones that are coming out. It's just, I do really like it, but it sucks that I was, like, this close to loving it. And then, once we kind of pass the hour mark, it kind of gets in that territory where it didn't really have, like, what it once had in the scenes prior, so... but it's still definitely worth looking at. I think people are really going to take to it, especially if this is, like, you know, the type of thing that they go for. Paulson has another movie coming soon, I think. I can't remember what it is now off the top of my head, but I know he's doing another one that we should be getting next year. Our second movie is The Stanford Prison Experiment. Another one I heard a lot about after Sundance. And it's... Obviously, we're dealing with another true story, I believe. And before you even see the monstrous cast list this thing has, the premise itself is something really intriguing, where they basically got 20 students together and just told them that they'd pay them $15 a day for this experiment, where they're going to be in a mock prison and... chosen totally at random, half of them are going to be prisoners and half of them are going to be guards. And then things start to get out of control when Michael Angarano, who is amazing in this movie, plays the guy who is the guard, who starts to take things way too seriously and gets, basically makes it a tyranny. And things get really out of control. And Billy Crudup is the guy running the experiment. And he's behind the wall, and when everybody's saying, this is getting out of control, the guards are getting out of control, we need to stop this, Billy Crudup wants to keep it going just to see how far it'll go. And we watch that line get pushed more and more and more as the movie goes on. We have the prisoner who just kind of tries to be the one to kind of stand up and, you know, start revolts and everything is Ezra Miller, who is amazing in this too. There's, Ty Sheridan, there is, Johnny Simmons, Nicholas Braun, who was in Red State with Michael Angarano, Moises Arias, a whole bunch of faces, you know, and a lot of them, because they're doing the whole, like, 70s look, some of them you can't even recognize. I didn't know Johnny Simmons until the credits, and this is just... Olivia Thirlby's in it too, also as Crudup's girlfriend, who's kind of gets in on the experiment halfway through. And this is really, really intense, engrossing stuff. And it's definitely like best of the year territory. The performances are insanely good. One of the great things is Angarano's character at the start realizes he reminds himself of Strother Martin from Cool Hand Luke. So he does that voice the whole time and kind of basically makes a character out of it that he loses control of. And this movie is really something to see. I really hope people check this out. It's in Redbox right now. So I would definitely, this is like, and it just, as it pushes further and further, you just cannot just take your eyes off it. And there's another guy I wish I could. I specifically looked it up. I think Sheffield's his last name. He's an actor. He's the one prisoner that, like, kind of has that zen quality to where he'll never be broken. But then you have that big scene where they push him as far as he can go. That dude is really... I feel shitty for not remembering his name. That dude was really good, though.
I'm looking forward to it.
So, yes, this is definitely something that you'll want to check out. And just everybody in this movie has a great performance in them that they show. I can't think of a weak link in it. And just the suspense that comes out. It's like you would think it's just a very, like, the whole thing is very simple. It's just 20 kids in the basement of a college. But this really, yeah, like I said, you won't be able to take your eyes off it. And for very good reasons.
Sheffield.
I think that's what's the name.
Chris Sheffield.
Yeah, I was thinking that, but I didn't want to say it if it wasn't right.
He was in Dark of the Moon and The Maze Runner.
Yeah, that's a little weird, but I don't really remember him off the top of my head in those movies, but if he does more stuff like this, hopefully more people will know his name without having to look it up. Our third movie is Tangerine, which you've probably heard a lot about. It's doing quite well as far as indie awards go. Like, it's the one that people are really, really taking to. And we have these There are two prostitutes. One of which is still, this is where you kind of, I'm not quite sure, what we're, there's a lot of terminology going on here, and I'm not quite sure which one's which, but the actresses are, we'll just say, I'm sure you've looked it up by now. As far as their characters go, as far as we know, one of them has a dick. They might both, that was never really touched on the other one, but, and they are basically going around town because and on Christmas Eve because one of them has just gotten out of prison and she's just had her heart broken by their pimp. So she's basically tearing all through town looking for him, and we meet the various characters they come across. Well, also there's a parallel story with an Armenian cab driver that seems like just this totally other thing that's going on, but everything has a way of coming together. And this is very, yeah, I wasn't sure this was gonna be my thing, but it's just, the thing about it is, one of the things it became immediately notorious for was the whole thing, was shot on iPhones. Like, three of them, I think. And they shot this whole thing on them, and then took through, like, some kind of filter or something to make it, give it that kind of, the bright quality that it has. So that in itself is really impressive and kind of opens a lot of doors to other people seeking this. And obviously the performances are really good. The one, obviously being the two of them, the one that's kind of considered our lead character, the one that just got out of prison, she's the one that's like really, really like off the wall, and the other one is like kind of the quiet type for the most part. Well, when they're together, they're kind of a, you know, a two-headed monster. But when they're separated, one's kind of the downplayed one, while the other gets to be the, I guess, the showy performance. And it's kind of like, in not completely, like, not all the way, but a lot of it kind of reminded me of a much flashier version of a Jarmusch movie. And I can't even really pinpoint what was giving me that vibe. I was just kind of getting it. and it's like a swift hour and 25 minutes, and that's really, there's really not much else to it apart from the basic plot, but the performances and just trying to distinguish where this is, all this is going to go and how all of this is going to kind of come together at some point. And it's not even really that, like, it's not even, like, a huge ceremonious thing when everything does come together. It's just kind of, it's a very kind of, it's kind of hard to say a movie so flashy and with such big performances is downplayed, but compared to other movies that would kind of have this whole, we feel like we're building to something quality, it kind of has probably a different turnout than one would expect, so there's that. There's also another subplot where she has found the other woman that her pimp has been sleeping with, and she's kind of dragging her all over town. It's kind of a, I guess, kind of a revenge thing. there's definitely a lot to like about this movie, and pretty much the whole package is what's to like about it. Just the style and the way it's shot, and how the performances themselves, and just how. Yeah, it's just kind of hard to fathom the way this movie was made, but it's very, yeah. Like I said, I'm hoping it, like, opens a lot of doors and stuff like that for other people than I would be seeing more movies like this, as long as they don't get played out, because that could totally happen, too. That's what happens with indie movies. You make one that's kind of innovative, and then hell breaks loose. But for now, we have this one as it is, and that is great. Our fourth movie is Nasty Baby. This is Sebastian Silva, I think is his name. It's his new movie. He did a couple of movies I reviewed a couple years ago, I believe, with Crystal Fairy and Magic, the Michael Cera double feature. This one does not have Michael Cera in it, but he is in it himself as the star of it. And he did The Maid as well. Something I still never got around to. I've been meaning to see that movie for like 6 years, and I've never gotten around to it.
First time we ever went to Athens.
Yeah. So, our plot here is, his friend is Kristen Wiig, and he and Kristen Wiig are trying to have a baby together. But of course, you know, he is, shit. I lost what I was talking about. Okay. Plot. Yes. I was going into plot and then criticism, and my thoughts kind of split ways in front of me. Okay. The plot is, he is gay, so he and Kristen Wiig are going to make a baby together artificially. But the trouble is he, there's a whole thing about him having trouble, and then they have to, bring his boyfriend in to possibly take care of the situation. On top of the fact that he is trying to do, like, an art exhibit where he is a giant baby. So he just gets on the floor and acts like a baby, and that's his art. There's that going on. and then there are people being harassed by the town nut job, who is the bishop, who is Reggie Cathy.
Yes.
And there is... That's basically what this movie is. The thing about it is, well, for starters, everybody here is really good. The main three are. I was kind of getting Rhino Runner Fassbender vibes from this, which is odd. Because you don't really, it's kind of weird to think of a modern day him, but that's just what I was getting from this. And the thing about it is, what this movie's been getting attention for, I kind of wish I didn't know what happened. I just knew that this movie took a turn. But at the same time, I kind of feel like it's, I don't know. The thing about it is, for the first hour, this movie is pretty much exactly what I just told you. And then that last half hour, it just turns into something totally different. And normally in this case, I would find that, like, intriguing and a bit, just kind of, I would embrace it for just how totally in another direction it went. But it's kind of, because when you, yeah. But the thing is, I didn't really, I feel like in any other movie, when this kind of thing would happen, it would really grab me, and I'd be like, I did not see that coming, let's see how this plays out. But it's just such a turn from what we had, and I was kind of fine where we were. I mean, yeah, there's really not a lot going on in that first hour. But it totally could have been, like, an entire movie of this and would have been fine. Before what happens, happens. And... I don't know. It didn't, like, ruin the movie or anything. Like, it's still fine the way it is. It's just, I didn't really, it just seemed kind of like an odd place to go. Like, it almost didn't, it didn't really fit. Like, there was, I get and I admire that it can be doing one thing and then just go in some direction that would be unexpected. But there was just really, just kind of tonally, even. It didn't really... I'm just really not sure where the decision came from that this movie needed to go in that direction. It didn't really make sense to me, but... still as it is, it's fine. The performances really hold it up, too. Like, Kristen Wiig is growing on me. I know I've been calling her a wannabe Parker Posey every time she does a part in an indie movie, but... yeah, everything is fine here. But it's just... Once we get to that last third, it's not bad. It's not something I overly, like, mind that they went with. It's just, I don't really feel it made a lot of sense in context. So, yeah. But it's fine. It's really fucking weird if that's the kind of thing you're into. And if you saw his other two movies, I think you'll be fine. all right. Let's get down to this. Our next movie is Meadowland. And Meadowland is a remarkable movie starring Olivia Wilde and Luke Wilson. It's totally a plot you've heard before. They're out driving, and they've got their son in the back seat, their little son, and they pull into a gas station, And then he goes into the bathroom, and they're, you know, hanging out in the convenience store. And then the kid vanishes into thin air, and they can't find him. And then a year goes by, and they're all over the place. He's a cop, and she's a school teacher, and they're pretty much in their own other worlds now, dealing with this in different ways. And he's kind of, his morals are kind of getting to be blurred, and she's just basically losing her mind. So, yeah, it's a lot like, I just talked about Stranger Land. Another movie that ends in land. It's basically this plot with Nicole Kidman and Hugo Weaving. But this movie just kind of, like, hit me in a way I wasn't expecting. Because, like I said, I just felt like we've seen this story a number of times. If you want to go all the way back to stuff like Picnic at Hanging Rock, the children disappear, adults go crazy story. It's been done a shitload of times. But this one really, really hits hard. And I think a lot of that has to do, there are a lot of great performances in it. There is a kick-ass supporting cast. There is, Elizabeth Moss has one scene, John Leguizamo is in there as somebody that kind of, Luke Wilson goes to one of those support groups and Leguizamo is there with his own troubles. Kevin Corrigan shows up towards the end. So many people, they're even slipping my head. My mind. The kid from Insidious plays a major role.
Ty Simpkins?
Yes.
Giovanni Ribisi?
Yes, Giovanni Ribisi is, I believe, I don't think it was really, like, specified in dialogue, but I believe he's Olivia Wilde's brother. He's, like, the kind of the freeloader type that's just kind of staying with them. But the thing that really, really makes this movie as powerful as it is yeah, I know. it seems like every time Olivia Wilde is in a movie now, I praise her more than I did the last time when I just thought I couldn't praise her enough already.
Right.
But oh my god. Oh my god, she is so unreasonably, unbelievably, any other adjective levels of great. Wow. In this. And yeah, like, Luke Wilson's really good too. I was just kind of talking about with Tangerine. Olivia Wilde's the one that gets to kind of, you know, really go off, and Luke Wilson's is more, his pain is internal, and he's kind of the downplayed one of the two of them. But she's working with a lot of internal stuff too. Her big scenes aren't as big as they probably could have been in something more melodramatic. But when they do come, they work completely because of how she sells them. And this just, it's another one where you just, once it happens, you just kind of get glued to it immediately. It really deals with the whole juggling morals thing. There's a really great scene with Leguizamo where he talks about, how he's actually thought about, how he would kill the guy that killed his daughter. And it's just kind of this whole thing where you're not quite sure if he's, like, fantasizing or planning. Not to mention he's talking to Luke Wilson, who is a cop and everything. Luke Wilson has a lot, I guess, given what the role is. Luke Wilson was giving me vibes of John C. Reilly in Magnolia.
Wow.
With this part. I don't know if it's just because he was playing the role of the sensitive cop or what it was, but Juno Temple has a scene, too. Like, the scene in Magnolia when he first meets Melora Walters. That scene's basically in this movie with him and Juno Temple. Luke Wilson and Juno Temple. But it doesn't feel like, I wasn't thinking about that till just now. So watching it wasn't like, this is ripping off Magnolia in a way a little bit.
That's good.
I just really kind of, yeah, it's very emotional, and at times it's suspenseful. and there's just, yeah, this is one of those movies where it didn't hit me right away. It wasn't like an hour into the movie and I was like, I am watching greatness right now. It was one of those ones that hit me like a few minutes after. And it's, yeah, if there's one problem I have, the ending cuts off a little early. Like, there's some things I want to know before this movie ends, or after this movie ends, but, I guess that's really says something when a movie leaves you wanting, though. I mean, at the same time, you can give it shit and say, dude, don't stop there. But at the same time, when a movie can leave you wanting that much, is really impressive. And something that doesn't come along that often anymore. So this really, I was not, I remember seeing the poster for this movie a while back, and it was just going to kind of probably come and go or whatever, be something I watched like later, but this is not what I expected from this movie in the best way possible. So yes, please seek that out if you can find it. Our next movie is Victoria. You've probably heard a lot about Victoria by now. People love Victoria. People really love Victoria. They love it a lot. And the reason they love it a lot is because it's pretty easy to mindlessly fall in love with a gimmick. Okay, look, that's not to take away anything from this movie, because the movie is 2 hours and 15 minutes and doesn't cut. It's one long take. It's Birdman without the cheap cuts. There are no cuts in it whatsoever. The whole thing is an actual 2 hour and 15 minute cut. I will give them credit for pulling that off. And that's about it. What the story basically is we see her hanging out in a club. Because if you want to really, really make the art house crowd love you, you have a scene set in a club with strobe lights. Artsy crowd loves that shit.
Yeah.
So, she eventually kind of befriends this little group of delinquents or whatever. And then they walk around and bullshit for about an hour and 15 minutes. And then she's kind of pulled into their world and so on. Things happen. I don't really know what's spoilery, so I'll just say she goes into their world. And yes, if this movie had not been the one long take that it is, I really don't know what it would have. Because everything else that happens, it's a fucking bare bones plot. The acting is okay. but really, it just really feels like it only serves the purpose to see. It was them saying, let's see if we can actually do this. And that's, apparently it took like 3 tries, I think. And even then, it's just this whole, like, I just, what was I just talking about? About the whole, it was the fight in Creed.
Mm-hmm.
Where everybody loves the long take now. So people basically know that if you can accomplish a really elaborate long take, that people will love you. Like, there's the, obviously there's all of Scorsese's. There is the one in Atonement. There is the one was in my head and then I just lost it. All the ones in Children of Men and just Cuarón in general. Let's just say Cuarón in general. And of course, we go to Birdman. And it was a big deal with Birdman. And now people are basically saying this movie is the Birdman effect. Because I guess we've all forgotten Russian Ark. A movie did this like... Russian Ark is, what, 1999? I could be totally off on that, but I think that's around the time that it was. So that would be 16 years ago that Russian Ark pulled this off. Mind you, Russian Ark's only like an hour 40, and I guess they thought the longer they made it, the more credit they'd get for the long take. But a lot of this is pointless. Like, 85% of this movie is pointless. that's all about it. But people love it. People love this movie. What? Did you find Russian Ark's date?
Yeah, is it 2002?
Oh, was it? Okay. I knew it was somewhere in that early 2000s area. So, yeah, I wasn't a fan of Victoria. But maybe people... I know gimmick is an easy word to throw out there. And I know you can say... There's stuff with meaning that people have dismissed because they feel it's a gimmicky, but... This movie made me feel absolutely nothing, and I was just kind of, just really desperately wanting it to stop. So, but, it's an A for effort with the whole, actually pulling that off without any cheap cuts or anything. The Silent House and its remake did this with only, like, what, two cheap cuts in it, I think.
Mm.
So fine. Like what you're gonna like, I guess. Our next movie is I Smile Back. Remember when I have been accusing Kristen Wiig of being a wannabe Parker Posey? Well, if there's anybody that I actually would buy taking the place of Parker Posey as a type of indie queen, I would nominate Sarah Silverman.
Yes.
Because after this and Take This Waltz, because she's really... There's a lot of things to love in Take This Waltz, and I think she's really, really underrated in it. She's really, really great in that movie. She's not there very much, and you have the great performances of Williams and Rogan and stuff like that. And the fact that the movie's just great in general, but she kind of seemed, she never really got much credit for that movie, but, yeah, she just really took me by surprise in that, and then here she gets the leading role and gets to do it as much as she wants now. And she is a really, really great actress, and I'm really afraid that, a lot of people aren't, there's a lot of people out there that aren't a fan of her as a comedian. And I'm afraid that kind of the way people already feel about her as far as that's concerned, that they would just kind of ignore the idea that she could be a really great actress. Because she really, really is. And this is, it's a very basic movie. It's really just an acting exercise where she is the wife of Josh Charles and they have kids and... Everything should be great, but the trouble is she has like a drug and alcohol problem and she disappears for long periods of time and fucks people and she's just all kinds of fucked up and they're trying to bring their family back together with her going to rehab and, you know, confronting her past and doing all that stuff. But this is one of those movies where just how good she is and how good everything, really, we have Josh Charles in this who's also really good. Chris Sarandon has a really good scene lead in the movie. But really the fact that the entire movie basically is her performance basically makes it all stand out. Cause this could be one of those cases where you just dismiss the movie and say, well, it has a great lead performance, but she just kind of made the entire movie around her better in general. Which is really impressive. it's not just that I think she was, I surprisingly really like the movie itself. There are some questionable things in there and I can totally get people not taking to it. Cause there are some very bizarre things in it. She basically fucks a teddy bear in her daughter's room while her daughter's asleep. That scene's weird.
I've heard about that scene actually.
But apart from that, it's really... It's mainly worth watching just for her performance, but like I said, her performance basically is the movie. So, the whole thing kind of worked for me, as a whole, so... That's something... If you like her as an actress, I'd definitely look into it. Otherwise, I'm not really sure that people are going to take this at all. Because there are... It does have some bizarre qualities, but, it really worked for me, so... That's what's important to me. Our next movie is Results, a movie that Kevin Corrigan is getting a lot of attention for. He was nominated at the Spirit Awards for it. And he walks into a gym run by Guy Pearce and Kobe Smulders and says that he wants to take private sessions. So Kobe Smulders becomes his trainer. But the thing about this is he is a millionaire that lives in a mansion that's entirely empty and we don't know how he got his money and we know that he's really weird. Just in general, he comes off as a really weird person to where we're not quite sure what his deal is or if he's trustworthy or any of those things. All the while Guy Pearce and Kobe Smulders kind of deal with their on again, off again relationship. Guy Pearce is really the main character here, and he's really good in this. He makes the character really, really likable, and I was never much of a Kobe Smulders fan before, but she's fine here. This movie is interesting. It certainly keeps you wondering what's going to happen. I don't know. It's kind of on that line between good and not so much. But there's also Anthony Michael Hall has a small part that's quite humorous as well. So yeah, there are there's a lot of comedic moments, mainly with Guy Pearce's character. It's certainly interesting when Guy Pearce is the comedic highlight of your movie, intentionally, of course. Because I never really, like, while watching him, I was, like, thinking about Leonard Shelby and Charlie Rakes, and I was like, this can't be the same dude, this is kind of awesome. Because he has conversations with his dog, and he makes his dog, like, talk back in a different voice, and he's one of those, like, athletic freaks that, like, just the first thing he does when he gets home is he has one of those things in his hallway that you, like, hang upside down on, and it's, like, an exercise routine, and it's... he's almost kind of like a parody of those guys, but also like a really good representation as well. So yeah, I actually, Kevin Gorgon's the one getting all the accolades, but, Guy Pearce probably stood out to me a little more as far as, the high point of this movie, but Corrigan also, if Corrigan can get a part where he gets noticed, everybody wins. Because he, of course, he deserves that. Not just, you know, in this movie, but in everything he's ever done. We just talked about him in Meadowlands.
Yeah, he's getting ready to say that, actually.
So, yeah, it's interesting. Like, it's not, like, a waste of time or anything. Maybe you will see it as a waste of time. It could go either way for you. But it's certainly interesting to see and guess and wonder where this movie's going and what is going to happen next. Because it's kind of, it's hard to decipher. Our next movie is Mistress America, which I don't really have a lot to say about, because I saw it a couple of weeks ago, and most of it is kind of getting pushed out of my head. Well, obviously, you know my thoughts on Francis Hall, I would think. If you don't, they're not positive at all. I don't have one positive thing to say about Francis Hall. Not one.
I'm totally not going to link that.
So, I was concerned going into this, because this is the next outing of a Noah Baumbach movie starring Greta Gerwig that they wrote together. Which is where Francis Hall came from. Like, as far as Baumbach's concerned, Squid and the Whale is one of my favorites. I really love Margaret at the Wedding. His most recent one, While We're Young, I liked.
Yeah, really good movie.
Greenberg, I'm half and half on. Oh. I don't hate it, but I don't particularly love it either. So, yes. His first movie, Kicking and Screaming with Eric Stoltz, it's good for a debut. Assuming that, was that his debut? I might be. I think I had this exact same thought process when I reviewed While We're Young.
You did, I'm pretty positive.
Okay. Now, the thing here, obviously, is that if you're gonna be invested in these movies, you have to like Gerwig and you have to like her thing.
Yes.
And I don't.
I do.
Don't. She's probably nice in real life, but when she's on a movie screen, count me out. So, she also did a movie called Lola Versus, which is just a fucking abomination. But speaking of that name, the real star of this movie is Lola Kirk, who is the sister of Jemima Kirk that you probably know from Girls. And she is likable enough. I'm sure I'd like her a lot more in a movie that's not this one. But having said all that, what I was getting to was, this is a lot better than Francis Hall. But seeing how low the bar was, saying it's a lot better is... We're still pretty low, but we're not Francis Hall low, so there's that. The characters around her kind of, I don't know, some of them kind of somewhat elevated, but then there's the others where it's very... We're just dealing with one of those characters that thinks saying something random and unrelated in the middle of a conversation is the heart of charm. It's charm personified. And just being just all around annoying is supposed to be funny and relatable and whatever the fuck. Clearly I'm just not one of the people, that this movie where people will, once again, as I was saying with Victoria, people love this movie. People really, really love this movie. I really don't. People love Francis Hall too, so fuck them anyway.
Hey now.
Yeah, that includes you. Fuck you, my friend.
I'm biased, though, so it's fair that I like this movie.
It's definitely more... It's got a story. There is that. A very paper-thin one, but it does have one. That all kinds... There's this very long scene at the house where everything kind of unfolds, and the movie shows somewhat signs of being something interesting in the early processes. But... for the most part, these Baumbach-Gerwig collaborations are not for me. That's what I'm saying.
Not for you, no.
That's right.
For me.
A Baumbach on his own, seems to be okay. But, you know. But like I said, though, I believe they are together, like in real life.
Lucky bastard.
So the way he sees her is going to be different than the way we see her. So, putting her at the center of a movie is going to be great for him. And that's good. I'm happy for him that he's able to do this. I just refuse to be entertained. I mean, I don't refuse to be entertained, but I would like to be entertained by it. But I don't think that's going to happen. So, but that's okay. Noah Baumbach is happy. And I am not watching his movie. So, really, he wins.
So, have you liked Greta in anything?
I'll have to get back to you.
Arthur?
What was that?
She was fine in Arthur.
It was in House of the Devil.
When she got like, when she got killed, yes. Yeah. That's the reason why you want
to
talk
about it. That's a terrible thing to say.
That's the reason why you want to bring that movie to Versus, because you want to talk about that.
Our next movie is Experimenter. We're not getting any better. Which is a shame. Which is such a shame. Because this movie stars in the lead role Peter Sarsgaard. Who I love. Oh my god, I love Sarsgaard. And when he got the lead role in a movie, I was like, oh my god, I'm there. And a lot of people learned it. Winona Ryder, Taryn Manning, John Leguizamo, Anton Yelchin, Jim Gaffigan... probably people I'm overlooking too. Anton Yelchin only has one scene, and he doesn't really add anything, and it's actually kind of funny because he's doing an accent, and he's got pedophile hair and a mustache.
Sounds fun. Like,
he really explores what he can do with his appearance. You got to give him credit for that, and his voice.
Always have.
And he's basically, it's another true story. Where Sarsgaard plays this unconventional experimenter. And there's morals and stuff like that, and then there's him getting involved with, like, media and all that. And the way I describe this movie is like this, because there's not a whole lot of interesting things happening in this movie. In fact, pretty much none at all. it's nice to have these performers get to come in and do a couple of scenes, and that's great, but... The actors that we're looking at in this movie deserve so much better than what this movie is. And there's not really... It's not a bad movie. It's just so fucking bland and dull. and there's really... There's a moment when we reach... There was a TV movie made about him that starred William Shatner and Ozzie Davis. And we actually get to see, like, the early stages of this, where he meets William Shatner and Ozzie Davis, and they talk about... how this movie's gonna go down, and I'm not sure who played William Shatner, but Ozzie Davis was played by Dennis Haysbert, who is a perfect casting choice. And that's when I was like, why is this whole movie not about making this TV movie with William Shatner and Ozzie Davis? If this were the whole movie, that would be great. In fact, I kind of just want to see an Ozzie Davis biopic starring Dennis Haysbert. Just give me that instead of this movie entirely. No, I was very disappointed because... Sarsgaard being the lead in a movie should be a lot better than this is. And there's nothing wrong with his performance or anything. It's not about that. It's just this movie is a fucking bore. And there's just... there's definitely interesting things that are touched on where it's like, maybe if they went in this direction or they went in this direction, we'd have an interesting movie on our hands. But they don't take any of those directions and we're stuck with what we have, which is really not a whole lot. so that's a bummer. Our next movie is I'll See You in My Dreams, which is Blythe Danner getting the lead role in basically what is a romantic comedy. So this is unconventional right off.
Yeah, very much so.
So we have her and her bridge club, who is, there were a few recognizable faces in it. The only one that's jumping out at me is Juden Squibb. And she has just lost a pet, so now she is alone. And then she meets a friendly pool boy, who is Martin Starr. And she also meets who could potentially be a new love in her life in Sam Elliott. And this, it's a very, this movie is very nice. It's very, it's one of those, I don't know, I'm not sure I would say feel-good movie, exactly, but it's very much, it's very, very light, and more so a comedy than anything, despite, a tragic element here or there. And it's mainly what, the main thing everybody's talking about is her performance, and, like, I've heard, pretty much nobody's talking about the movie, it's all about just her performance. Which is really, this, because you don't really hear much about her performances, like, even in her early days. There was never really that one performance that really stood out. The most people know her for is Meet the Parents. But here she gets to be the starring role and gets to have all the emotions and all everything to work with here. And she does everything you would expect a veteran of this would do with it, which is really great things. And it goes in directions that you don't think it will, which is very interesting, given anything like this. And it's very, yeah, you do get the scenes, like, when she's with her bridge club, it's like, yeah, they're funny old ladies, and then, yes, there's a scene where all the old ladies get high. Yeah, that scene is in here, but apart from stuff like that, this movie really doesn't go in the places you think it will. Starting with the fact that the first person we see re-enter her life after a tragedy strikes is Martin Starr. That's not expected. and you just kind of wonder where these different things are going to go. And yes, it's for the most part a really nice movie. And yeah, it does have, you know, emotional moments here and there. And yeah, it's fine. It's more, like, it's actually a good movie. It's not just, you know, she finally gets the chance to shine in a leading role. It's, the whole movie is quite good, actually. So, yeah. Okay. Our next movie is One of Two Things. I have heard it pronounced Advantageous.
Never heard that
before. I've heard it pronounced Advantageous. It's one of those. And it is a story of a woman who is fired from her... We're in, like, a futuristic sci-fi world. A very, very... we're in indie sci-fi again. I'm telling you, that genre is going to be huge. Like, it's going to have a huge, like, list of movies that qualify. And she's just been fired for her job. And she has to try to take care of her daughter and get her into the nicest school possible. A daughter who came from an affair, so she has nobody but herself to help support this. So she comes across the likelihood of this program that could put her in, because she's aging and she's getting older, but this program could take her mind and put it in a younger body. It's, yes, it's that Ryan Reynolds banging the movie Selfless that I fucking hated. But, it's not a really stupid, dopey action movie. This is, it's much more of a drama. And the whole thing is about, it's not so much about her older mind being in the younger body. It's how she goes about making the decision of whether to do this or not. So, it's a totally different thing from that point. There's one recognizable face in it. And we see the potential most likely father of this child is Ken Jeong, who is married with children and everything, who she goes to for help and does not receive it, and she just kind of has to go through all these obstacles, and she's really, it really should be a last case scenario going through this whole thing. The trouble is, the most of the movie is her whether or not she's going to make that decision or not. And yeah, there are a lot of interesting ideas here, and they, it's interesting to see the world they set up and the futuristic details they give it. The performances are really, really good. There's a lot of emotional resonance. It just doesn't quite have a lasting power. Like, there's... with the direction it goes, this movie should be a lot more powerful than it is. There's something that's not quite here that probably should be. That really gives it the hit home that it needs. But it's worth checking out just for its premise and how seeing a movie like this on such a low budget. It's up for the John Cassavetes Award at the Spirit Awards, which means it was really fucking cheap. This movie was made on practically no money, is what that means. So yes, it's worth checking out. And the lead actress is really, really good. So yeah, it just once it reached the end and it was over, it just kind of felt like there was something that wasn't there that probably should have been, to make the emotion hit harder. So even though it doesn't kind of feel like it hits exactly where it wants to, it's still worth checking out. Unlike our next movie is ironically titled Entertainment. Entertainment is about a really, really bad stand-up comic who is going through the Mojave Desert doing a bunch of shitty shows, and trying to contact his daughter, I guess, his long-lost daughter or whatever. And that's about it. He comes across John C. Reilly. The guy that opens for him is Ty Sheridan, who is... he's supposed to be a clown, but he's basically a mime. And there is one inexplicable scene in a public bathroom with Michael Cera. And Dean Stockwell. Acting legend Dean Stockwell is in this movie for like 10 seconds and basically in the background. I don't know who was involved in the making of this movie that knows him personally and just said, "Hey, come on over. We'll just kind of put you in this scene." Legendary actor Dean Stockwell. but okay. Now, I had heard that this movie was an acquired taste. So I was pretty much prepared until I saw some credits. And it occurred to me that I should have fucking known. It's a movie about a bad comedian. The people that this it basically is the Tim and Eric area.
Oh no!
Tim is a credited writer on it, and I think the guy that's in it's like had their paths have crossed before. And this guy is the director of a movie called The Comedy that starred Tim, and it had Tim and Eric in it, and the guy from LCD Sound System, who is apparently a friend of theirs, James Murphy, I think is his name. Yeah. And The Comedy is dreadful. The movie The Comedy is dreadful to an extent. Like, I get it, okay? I get, like, what Tim and Eric do, like, the anti-comedy thing. I just think they're reprehensible. I cannot fucking stand them. I cannot fucking stand the sight of them. And Tim and Eric's billion-dollar movie is one of the worst movies I've ever seen in my life. I understand that they have a fan base, and I understand that this totally works for people with that kind of sense of humor. Never. Never in a million fucking years will this be my thing. Will their thing be my thing. And, yes. And this is just... look, I understand that he's a bad comedian, but the issue is that because of what the plot is, we have to watch his stand-up routines.
Ooh.
Now, instead of establishing that he's a bad comedian and us seeing it play out and we're like, yep, he's a bad comedian, because we're coming from the level of Tim and Eric style humor, his really bad comedy routines are stretched out and go on and on and on until you are ready to commit suicide from watching this movie. So, they got the point across, at least, that he's a bad comedian. We just have to put up with a lot of really insanely dreadful scenes stretched out long beyond when the point has been made, because that's just what they do. I don't even know if we're supposed to find it funny, because he's portrayed as being one of the worst comedians ever, but at the same time, what he does in his act is basically the Tim and Eric thing. So, I don't even know what the fuck this is trying to say. Maybe that's what the people see in it, that see something in it, and they find that very fascinating. Maybe they do, I don't know, but, this and pretty much anything I see one of, if not both of their names on, is going to be really, really excruciating to me. I think he was in a movie not that long ago, I think, that was actually, it was like a weird movie for him to be in, but I can't remember what it was. Yeah, I was not, and it just gets worse and worse as it goes. Like, I was trying to hang on for a while. I hung on to it for a good half hour or so. Trouble is that there's over an hour after that, and it just gets more, and it's trying to be really artsy, too, and most of the movie is just him sulking. Like, he'll do a bad comedy routine, and then he will sulk and sulk and fucking sulk, and then we repeat, and that's what the movie is on a loop. And I get that they're going kind of going for the mundane thing, because it's set in the middle of the desert, but good God.
Sounds horrendous.
I don't like this movie. I don't like this movie at all. That's what I'm trying to tell you. Our last movie is Glass Chin. I knew it was. I don't know why I had to theatrically look at my notepad, but
you're good.
Our last movie is Glass Chin, which is this kind of crime indie thing starring Corey Stoll as an ex-boxer who gets pulled into a crime boss's world. The crime boss is Billy Crudup.
A lot of people repeating in these movies.
Yeah. So, we have, and there's a lot of faces of Parliament here. We have Maren Ireland got a Spirit Award nomination for this. She is Corey Stoll's girlfriend that he lives with. There is David Johansen, of all people, pops up in a scene in this movie. That really pleased me. This movie, I was into this movie for a little while. I kind of felt like this movie was going to maybe really be something that I could go into. The first, like, 20 minutes or so are right out of The Drop, the Tom Hardy movie from last year that I fucking love. This movie was really building itself up like it was going to be something like The Drop. Like, a lot. But it really does not go in the directions it needs to. Like, it really sets itself to be something, and then it just totally loses itself. Like, totally. Because, first off, it's a crime movie. Like, a pulpy crime movie. And it's shot like a Woody Allen movie. Like, there's the opening shot, that looks like a Woody opening shot, but then you have these scenes that play out. And the way these scenes go out is, you know exactly what I'm talking about. If you've seen at least 5 Woody Allen movies, you know what I'm talking about. Those scenes where the camera is stationary, and the scene just kind of happens, and dialogue overlaps, and people have, you know, go back and forth, and sometimes they'll go out of the frame, and then they'll come back into the frame, but while this whole thing goes down, the camera just kind of stays here. Scenes like that that do not fit the tone of this movie whatsoever. A lot of those scenes being, the characters, the couple here, Corey Stoll and Maren Ireland's characters, are a couple who have apparently been living together for a long time, to the point that, they pretty much fight about everything. And it gets to the point to where I was curious what her performance was like because of the Spirit nomination, and it came to the point that I started to dread every time she was on screen. Because every time, not because her performance is bad, but because every single time she was on screen, it meant that the scene was going to descend into them fighting about something totally and completely mundane, just to show where their relationship's at. And it's about really, really stupid shit, too, and they go on and on. And it's just like, You know that couple you don't like hanging out with because all they do is fight? It's like watching them star in their own movie.
Oh, boy.
That sounds like fun, doesn't it? And it's trying to be a crime movie. And, yeah, okay, it probably sounds cool when I say Billy Crudup as a crime boss in a pulpy crime movie. I don't know what he was doing here. I don't think he knows what he was doing here. Because he's trying to do kind of like the stoic crime boss thing, like a Bernie Rose type thing or something. The trouble is he's like, it's kind of like he's still playing Dr. Manhattan. To where he's like, his expressions are like frozen and he speaks in monotone, which I guess is supposed to be threatening. I don't know, but Billy Crudup's got a lot of great performances. I just talked about one of them. It was like right around the exact same time as this. But this, I don't know what happened here with him, but, or with this movie in general, because, and then, like, the whole thing is the plot, like, the plot outline, if you look it up, is that, Corey Stoll's character gets framed for murder. The way that storyline happens is, the movie is an hour and 25 minutes, and for an hour, we just watch him go through his life, and we meet the people he knows. There's a side plot about him training a boxer, because he's a retired boxer that's once completely out of that scene, but they bring him in because they want him to train this new boxer. And we get that, and then with like 25 minutes left, we don't see the murder take place, we don't see the framing take place, we don't see anything at all leading up to this. We don't even really see... What happens here is he goes and he meets his girlfriend at a diner, and he says, I've been framed for murder. Oh no. And then they talk about it. And then it just doesn't come up until the last scene of the movie. As we're ending. It's like, well, we kind of need to end the story. We should give the movie a plot. Let's have him framed for murder. And then they're like, yeah. And then they just kind of do that. And they're like, oh shit. We forgot we framed him for murder. We should probably bring that up in the last scene before it ends. It's like, they ended the movie and then they're like, oh shit, I forgot we framed him for murder. Let's write a scene in where this comes back into play. Oh. And it's just really... The whole direction is just off. Like, not only is those weird moments where it's like mimicking Woody Allen of all things, but the way it's kind of cut together where it's like, we'll have one scene where two characters are talking, and then we cut from one character to the other, and the character we cut to, it's like they're in a totally different scene. Like, I kind of thought scenes would, like, abruptly cut off, and we'd go to other scenes, and then it's like, oh no, that's the dude he's talking to. It just looks totally and completely different from what we just cut from, and then back to. I don't know. So yeah, there was something good in this movie somewhere, but they just went totally off the rails, and I don't know what the fuck happened. So, yeah, that was kind of a bummer. Another one where it's like Corey Stoll in the head of a movie, that should be interesting.
Should be.
And yeah, he's totally not bad, it's just, what the fuck is this movie? Alright, that's it. We went longer than I wanted to, but...
Yeah, we're going star amounts real quick, end of the tour.
3.
Stanford Prison Experiment.
3.5.
Tangerine.
3.
Nasty Baby.
2.5.
Meadowland.
3.5.
Victoria.
2.
I Smile Back.
3.
Results.
2.5.
Mistress America.
2.
Experimenter.
2.
I'll See You in My Dreams.
3.
Advantageous.
2.5.
Entertainment.
We'll say 1.5.
God damn.
That's really generous, though.
Glass Chin.
2.
So it's another edition, our second edition for the week of AJ's Movie Reviews. Next week we'll be talking about In the Heart of the Sea as well as Room and possibly more. We'll find out soon. Tomorrow versus your cryptic comment is Happy Horror Days, and you probably know exactly what we're talking about. And if you're a fan of that versus and you're a fan of Halloween Horror Nights, 7 o'clock tomorrow night will be the final Halloween Horror Nights 25 podcast here on this channel. So that being said, I want to thank you guys and girls out there for watching. AJ, any parting words?